Blackstone presents The Tutankhamun Murder by Roy Lewis. This book is read by John Lee. Prologue. 1923. The bastard was keeping him waiting, of course, deliberately. A typical civil service trick, Howard Carter thought angrily. He was being kept waiting by a small, pompous, self-opinionated man seeking to inflate his own feeling of self-worth. From outside the building, across the courtyard beyond the embassy gardens, he could hear the rattle of a cart in the sweltering heat. Here in the anteroom it was cooler, but he could feel the sweat gathering in the small of his back, staining his shirt. Above his head, the ceiling fan circulated rhythmically, sending out a regular thunk, thunk, thunk sound. He shifted in his seat, feeling the anger in his chest thicken, knotting like a red-hot ball as he glared at the clerk seated behind the desk at the other side of the room. The minor official, neatly dressed in a collar and tie, was young and smooth-cheeked, fair hair carefully parted, spectacles perched on the end of his nose, and seemingly impervious to the heat. A minion, but a Cerberus, nevertheless. As the anger began to rise in Carter's throat, the clerk, perhaps sensing the frustration that gripped his guest, raised his head, smiled. "I'm sure Sir Leonard will see you soon." From the street outside came the subdued hum of the Cairo traffic, muffled by the expanse of garden at the embassy. Carter had always hated this place, because of its shibboleths, its airy dismissal of the realities of the outside Egyptian world, its stuffy, self-important officials, but most of all because of its refusal to support his cause, with its careful kowtowing to Egyptian sensibilities in the face of wholesale corruption and mendacity. He leant his head back against the wall, brushed the back of his hand against his small, neatly trimmed mustache. Carter closed his eyes, controlling the anger in his chest, preparing himself for the meeting to come, but at the same time allowing his thoughts to drift back to those moments, last December, which he knew would continue to be the self-defining moments of his life. He recalled the absolute, riveting silence that had greeted him when he went down to the site that day, the first excitement that had thundered in his veins when he heard how the boy had raised the alarm, and then the men had shown him the first step, outlined there in the dust. They had worked furiously clearing away the sand, and the steps led downward, through the hidden centuries, until finally he had found the broken shards in the entrance, the scattered pottery, and there, on the door, the familiar motif that had appeared on many tombs in the valley, the jackal in triumph above the 9 bound captives, the motif of the necropolis of the Valley of the Kings. He recalled now how his hands had been trembling as he brushed away the dust and rubble from the base of the door. There were more broken shards of pottery. He could make out the cartouches stamped upon the clay, Smenkhkare, the seal of the pharaoh, and saw what he knew was the doorway to the tomb. The blood had hammered in his throat when he realized that the seals on the door itself were unbroken. He had never been a man in complete control of himself, but he held on to his excitement then, as he held on to the simmering anger now. Immediately, he was certain he had discovered a tomb. He had wired his friend, benefactor and patron, the 5th Earl, Lord Carnarvon, at home in England. "At last, have made wonderful discovery in valley, a magnificent tomb with seals intact. Recovered same for your arrival. Congratulations." After an initial hesitation, there had been so many false alarms in the past, Earl Carnarvon had replied that he would be coming out from England to the Valley of the Kings post-haste. They had both known this was their last chance after years of endeavour in the sand of the valley. The money had run out, it was to be the last year of digging. But they had succeeded at last, and succeeded beyond dreams, beyond all realistic expectations. Carter had boarded the felucca and drifted along the broadening flow of the Nile to spend a few days preparing for the visit of his patron, making plans for the next few months' work. When the train had come lumbering into the station at Luxor, he had been there on the crowded platform to meet them as they alighted. The provincial governor had been at his side, of course. News of the discovery had inevitably leaked out, even though no one knew for certain what really lay under the rubble the workmen had...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.